And for me, it's really important that I don't have the queen and hearts in my hand. It's really for me, because I don't blocking like king, queen, queen,
okay,
jack of
Rene,
hearts.
Rene, 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 I have to stop you here. I have to stop you here. Let's crash. All right, here we go. Today, Rene Mastermix joining me for reviewing his second place in the Micromillion main event with 35,000 runners, which is quite impressive. We're going to be going over a couple of key hands, and especially in those larger fields, it is quite important to play, sorry guys, to play very exploitative. So it's very interesting to see some raw live footage. And yeah, we're going to be sharing our thoughts. So Rene, thank you for joining me here today and taking the time.
Yes, I really appreciate it.
Yeah?
Yes?
Yes? Two Germans are speaking English. That's always going to be. Yes? Yes?
Yes? Say something?
Yeah, no. René is also streaming on Twitch, mostly in German, or actually just in German. So if you don't speak German, that's a bit of a bummer. But yeah, we're trying our best here today to provide you with some very good poker knowledge. And when did you start your journey as a poker player? And taking poker a little more serious. How many years ago was it?
Yeah, like 2 years.
Two years ago.
Seriously.
Mm-hmm.
Poker playing like 15 years, 18. I start a little bit to poker, but not seriously. A lot of gambling and young player dreams and something like this. But now for 2 years, I start with the stream and I have really big scores last year, but I don't study really. And this year, I think I want to improve my game. And at the start of this year, I work with Ratio Edge, with Icemizer, and
mm-hmm.
Study a little bit my game, my weakness. And yes, I thought last year I was a good player, but this year I think I'm I'm like 100 times better than last year,
mm-hmm.
because I'm coaching in German and I have a really big community. We talk a lot of hands in the streams and everything. I really love it to have such a round of the poker community,
mm-hmm.
to improve my game. This is so much value for me.
That's
and
cool.
I really appreciate this.
Yeah, I always also enjoy coming on your stream and you have a great community, so I also enjoy that a lot. All right, let's get into some hands. That's what we're here for. So we selected six hands. Maybe we're going to be able to do more. All right, let's look into the first hand, ace three off. You decided to call. I think it would also be reasonable to three with this hand. You apply a lot of pressure on him. But yeah, I think these hands, ace three off, ace five off, are fine. And we're going to be very polarized, right? Even a jack 10 suited is not too bad. So, not the worst flop.
Yes, well, yeah, not flush draw, good equity.
How do you continue against this bet?
Yeah, I think the 30%, I don't know, he takes a lot of time. And I don't really want to call this hand, because he has like ace jack or ace 10. He had so many hands that can I break pressure on. And I like to raise here this hand, because I had a lot of two pairs, flushes, sets maybe. When I have so strong hands, when I check raising my range, I think I need a little bit like this hand to check raise also, or some other hands. When my opponent c-bets a lot and not like a good size, I think.
I mean, we have a nut flush draw. It's a pretty small pot. You can do whatever you want to do. We don't need to complicate things here a lot. In general, I would not try to think about, okay, I need to have bluffs here as well. I would just think, does it make sense to bluff? Like, this is a bit of... goes a little bit too much into, I want to be balanced, I want to play GTO. Instead, hey, does he have hands? He's folding against my race. Do we have a chance to improve our hand if we are called? And yes, so it's a good race. right? You can have jack 10 in hearts, you can have king jack in hearts, you can have ace 10 in diamonds with folding out a lot of better hands, you can have pocket eights without a club that he might fold against the raise. So yeah, wouldn't. Yes. All right, we make the nut flush on the turn. What was your thoughts? What were your thoughts on this turn, and how do you play your hand now?
Yeah, we had a lot of hands together, and I was thinking, okay, it's like a leveling thing against us. We had a lot of pots, and
how do you know? Like, how do you know that there's a leveling thing going on?
Yeah, because of the hands we saw in the showdown.
Mm-hmm.
Was some hands was like a little bit crazy, that he's raising and calling and sometimes he's checking. It was a little bit weird, the dynamic between us.
Mm-hmm.
And when he's like calling on the flop, I think he had a lot of he's had a lot of hands that play on the turn that continues.
Okay.
So I think a bet here is good. He had like king queen is this range. maybe he has like pocket jacks or tens with a club, nines or eights with a club. So I decide to bet like 40%. I think it's okay. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't go too big. I think this is the maximum sizing.
Yes.
Because even with our bluffs, let's say if he has queen jack and hearts or ace queen without a club, then and we have, let's say, we bluff 6-5 on the turn, 6-5 and hearts. We just have some air balls from the flop that are an open and straight draw. And we want to continue bluffing those. Like, just by betting 6 big blinds, we accomplish a lot. And I think in general, this card is not so great for him because he's going to have a lot of mediocre hands, especially when we have the ace in clubs. It's like really hard for him. He can't have like the king of clubs anymore, for example, right? So yeah, he can have jack in clubs, like queen jack clubs, pocket jacks, but yeah, more often he's going to have like a medium strong hand or a two pair or a set, as you said. But yeah, it's I would just not go too big here. Oh, you bet, wait.
Seven.
You bet, wait, it says
39%, I think.
It's already, yeah, you. Yeah, you bet 7, sorry, yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
I think 6 big blind 7 is one quarter, yeah. One third, it's okay.
River is dicey. How do you
Yes, I think on the river I made the biggest mistake in this hand. Yes, I don't really like my play here. I don't know. Maybe I have to bet small fold maybe if he's jam. Maybe I have to check sometimes, but I think bet small and folding is the best reason here. But when I size to bet like half pots, I don't think I can fold when he's jamming. But I don't, in this situation, this was a mistake I made.
But what you brought up the point that you had some level war going on. What does it mean? Like, what? How do you want to, how do you perceive him? If you had this level war, does he perceive you as an aggressive opponent that you were yes. playing back again? Okay, why don't you just go all in?
Yes, this was also yes.
Like, why? I mean, if you have this crazy dynamic going on, it's all right, great. But then, I mean, we got yes. a nut flush here. Then just go all in and hope he calls you with pocket jacks, king jack, queen jack. He's not gonna fold the second nut flush, right?
Yes.
And also, yeah, from his perspective. We're not gonna bet. We're not gonna bet jack or ten in clubs. We're either gonna be on a flush, but even a full house is very unlikely because we would be checking at the turn. But we can have 6-3, 4-6-5, 6-8 without a club. So for him, if he is on a decent flush, he's not gonna be folding it.
Yes, but I think when I maybe jam, maybe he's folding like pocket nines with a club or pocket tens.
But you just said you have like this level war going on.
Yeah, not so high. It was okay.
But that's the problem. Then you end up leveling yourself. That's just
Yeah, and that's why I'm bringing up. That's why I'm bringing it up. That's why I'm not doing this level shit anymore. Because at the end of the day, you don't know to what an extent your opponent is leveling, and you just end up leveling yourself.
Yes. I think this was the biggest mistake in this tournament, this leveling. But I think the jamming is the option. But when I'm... Do you see option to bet small on and folding?
Yeah, that it's fine as well. Yeah, you bet 15. I don't mind. I think that's also fine. If you bet 7 big blinds, just block bet, or even 5 big blinds and then fold to an all-in. Yes. Because he's not going to have any bluffs anymore, right? And people in these stages, he's not going to jam ace-queen. Like, he's also not going to have a pure queen that he can bluff with. Right? His main bluffs would be something like king-queen. But he's not jamming that.
Yes, and
I think against the average player, I like the small block bet on the river. But the moment if you say you have some crazy dynamic going on, then just go all in and then just go with your reads. I mean, why do you have those reads in the first place?
Yes, I think yes, that's what is. I don't like this play. I knew it in this moment, and I thought, when I'm betting so big, I cannot fold if he's jamming.
And yeah, I mean, you get an insane price. I mean, 10 more big blinds for a pot of 70 big blinds. And not so much you can do anything about it. I mean, I would not say it's like a big mistake. I think you're quite hard on yourself here. I just don't like the entire thought process and focusing so much on the leveling thing. He might just be from nature an aggressive player, and then you think he's just doing it against you, because that's what a level war means, right? That you think he's doing something special against you to outplay you or play back. But maybe it's just his nature to be an aggressive player, and he's just playing his game against you. And now you make huge adjustments, way too many adjustments, because you think there's some weird level war going on. This is very dangerous. So just play your game, and if you see certain hands or showdowns that are worthy to take a note on or to consider for future hands, then do so and make your adjustments. Yes. Right? It can be very dangerous.
Yes, I lost.
But I don't think it's a big mistake, man. Like, I think you're quite hard on yourself. Because this stack to pot ratio, I mean, that you get the money in there with a nut flush. Like, and yes, I would never check. Like, what do you hope to pay? But what do you hope from a check? Like, what do you think is going to happen?
I think checking is not also a good option. I think to bet small and fold when he's jamming is the best option.
Yeah.
Quite best option. And then, because I had some reads on him, big, good reads. I mean, I think I bet small and he's jamming, I can easily fold this hand. But,
exactly.
But when I'm committing myself to the pot, I have no option. And this is what I hate in this spot.
Yeah.
Because, okay, I can maybe jam. This was good in the idea. But betting small and when he's then jamming, I know it. I have the biggest answer from him.
Yeah, absolutely. I also like just block bet and then fold. Yes. All right, king jack suited. 3-bet from the small blind.
Yes, the king jack was really, really interesting hand, I think. Mm-hmm. We have the button open raise, 3-bet. And I decide to 4-bet this hand.
Yeah,
I think it's a good option here. I have the good blockers to the kings, jacks, ace king.
Yeah,
I make a lot of pressure against pocket tens, nines, ace jack, ace queen. I like it. I don't know what do you say. Do you say?
What do you think I'm gonna say?
I hope you like it.
I also like it. It's a good
more,
play.
Maybe you like more something like ace 10 or something. Maybe
no, both are fine. The king jack, with broadways in general, you want a strong block, strong pairs, kings, ace king, jacks. But also king, jack, king, queen, you see that actually often in those GTO sims as well, is you unblock a lot of his ace-x bluffs, right? Because at the end of the day, he's going to have more ace-x bluffs, like ace-5 suited, ace-6 suited, ace-jerk-off, than aces and ace-king combos. I mean, it's not that much more. He's also supposed to be flatting with a lot of ace-x, but oops, it's still quite a lot of ace-x combos. And king-jack, so he's also bluff 3-betting with more ace-x than king-x. Yeah. So that's why it's not too bad to have a king queen suitors of also a very high frequency 4-bet in these spots. So yeah, I really like it.
Okay.
Check.
Yes, the flop comes. Do you want to see bet here? I decide to check it back on the flop.
Mm-hmm. I think both options are fine. This is literally whatever.
Yes, we can maybe bet and make some pressure on like sevens, eights, ace highs.
Yeah.
Something like this, but on this, maybe when he's calling my four bets, so he has, I think he has a strong range to call this four bet. And I maybe run into aces, kings or something. Maybe he has pocket nines, tens. So I think to bet here, it's a little bit more dangerous. I can take the pot on turn or river, I think.
Yeah, but and I have. It's fine, yeah. Hmm? Yeah, makes a lot of sense, yeah. So, yeah, as I said, it's whatever on the flop. You can bet, you can check. I don't expect a lot of raises. I think 10s or 9s just call. I agree there might be some slow plays in aces and kings that want to raise the flop. Turn, you check.
Yes. What do you think? Turn, I have to bet or?
No, I mean, it's a 4-bet pot. You still have 50 bigs behind. I don't think you can bet turn jam river. So you only have one street of value.
Yes.
So, yeah, I like your check back on the turn. It's either bet turn, check river or check turn and bet river. River, he jams. That's interesting.
Yeah, it was so crazy. He's like, against this, it was really... I had like time bank, like, I don't know, 1.5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I was really thinking about the situation, what kind of hands he can jam. In this situation, in the low stakes or mid stakes, it's like a $20 tournament. In this situation, when you check your hands down, I think I see the players overacting extremely. It's like sometimes you're checking the flop with like the top pair or something, like on the turn they're jamming and I see it a lot of times. This is like maybe like 5 or 10% I put in this situation.
Mm-hmm.
That when I am underwrap my hand, they jamming too much and try to steal the pot.
Okay.
This is like a situation I see a lot of times, and I had a lot of like this hands.
Okay.
Then I was thinking about my hand. What is this? I really want like pocket queens or jacks here in this situation, or I think king jack is maybe the better call. What is my weakest hand I can call here? So I think the king jack is really close. Because I'm blocking the jack queen, what is good, but I don't know if he's calling the 4-betting with jack queen. He can bluff like ace queen or ace jack here. And when I'm checking two times here, he's thinking about that I have no good hand. Maybe I have like ace 10 or something or ace 9 that I don't bet. I don't know if he's really thinking about my hand.
Yeah.
And then I decide to call here. I think it's not like 100% call, but it's like when I'm thinking about my callings here, what hands can I call really?
Yeah.
And yes,
it's you approach a bit more from, I feel like also a bit more from a feel base. I just like to think about, okay, what can you have? Right. As you said, You think a bit more, okay, what he's trying to accomplish, maybe tries to get me off an ace queen or ace jack. I like to reverse it. I try to focus on, okay, what are his potential value hands? I doubt he's going to do that with a boat. I think you want to get He also wants to induce calls from ace queen or ace jack high, maybe induce a raise. Often they also go for a check jam or a check call if we go all in ourselves. I also think that in these tournament stages, king queen offsuited is not going to be called against the 4-bet, and king queen suited is also going to be called very often pre-flop. So his range is going to be a lot of ace jack, ace queen. And then I definitely see some 7-8 suited. No, I don't think nines goes nines? All in. No.
Okay.
I just think nines and tens usually bet smaller to, you know, induce something perhaps. So I can definitely see a slight chance of king queen. I can see a slight chance of king jack. But then I just see a whole lot of crap.
Yeah, it's like the same. I was thinking, okay, is he really jamming a full house here? Is he really doing? And then when I think he's not doing this, I really like to block the jack queen.
Yeah, but even queen jack, I'm not so sure if he calls it in this stage against the 4-bet.
Yes.
I think it's like mostly suited aces because they play so much better. Very often you just flop a strong nut flush draw and you can just check jam it on the flop or play it aggressive. I just think. And he's going to have a lot of these ace 8 diamonds, ace 7 diamonds, maybe the ace jack and diamonds, ace 5 diamonds. And these are, if he has already 3-4 combos and he's not having a lot of boats, then we already get, as I said, king jack we split against, maybe has 1 or 2 combos of king queen, maybe 1 or 2 combos of 10s or 9s he jams. But then he has these busted non-flush draws, and then
yeah, we already... Do you think he's bluffing like ace jack of diamonds of clubs?
Could also be possible, right? Yeah. I don't hate his jam. Yeah, it's. I also don't like his preflop call. I mean, I don't think against your code, he's just doing okay against your king jack and king queen that you might be 4-betting with. But even against your other bluffs, like maybe an ace 8 or ace 9 suited or an ace jack, he's dominated, right? Then you still have aces, kings. So I think this is just a very bad preflop call, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think, I thought the same. I marked him as a not so strong player, and then I decide to play this hand like this. I like to 4-bet this hand. I like the checks on flop and turn. I really like it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, yeah, it was the biggest pot.
Yeah, sick. Yeah, that puts you far ahead.
Yeah.
I think in general, and also for everyone that is watching, I think cold 4-betting is quite powerful because usually people are not that sticky. I'm quite surprised. I mean, you will always see some outliers. But in general, it's pretty good to be very aggressive with cold 4-betting. If you of course have the stack to do so, and usually get the folds here. This guy just doesn't like folding. This happens. Jack 8, yes. Hijack. Yeah, it's all right. Wait, is this small blind calling as well? Wait, is this?
Oh no, a big blind.
Ah, he's probably was just seated. He didn't get a hand. Okay. All right.
Jack
so
eight. Jack 8. Yes, I'm in the big blind.
Yeah, all good.
Yeah. Okay. He's c-betting?
Yeah.
I like to raise this hand here. In this on the flop on the 10-5-6. I'm really blocking his jack 10 and 10-8, something like this. I get to fold ace high, king highs. And I think the most of the people here see betting a lot of hands, and yes, I like to make a little raise here, because I can, when the turn improves my hand, like a 7 comes or a club comes or something like this, or a 9, I can bluff it 2 or 3 times. I have to go it.
Yeah.
But what do you think?
Yeah, I like the fact that he bets small. Usually if people have pocket jacks or ace 10, they would bet bigger. So it's already an indicator that he's probably not so strong. So, and also your hands, as you said, you can improve to straight draws, flush draws. So yeah, it's a pretty good raise.
Yeah, then comes the best part in the deck, I think. Maybe Jack is maybe better, but
yeah.
When it's not a Jack, I think the 7, it's a really good card.
Yeah.
To bluff.
Yeah.
Yeah, I picked in like the 40%.
You have to be very careful with your sizings, because if you bet now, you have 33 big blinds on the river and you have 36 behind. I would just try to choose a sizing where you have around at least pot left on the river and not more than pot, just something small.
Yeah, it's like something like 5, or what do you think?
No, just you need to bet bigger on the turn, not smaller.
Bigger, okay.
Yeah.
But when I have a flush, I big, also big? I betting big with my whole range?
Yeah, I mean, you are going to have way more stronger hands on this turn, right? So you want to choose a sizing where you can put them all in. So I would probably bet around 10 to 12 big blinds. Then you have 30 big blinds behind roughly. And then the pot are, 40 to 42 big blinds.
Okay.
Yeah.
But when he's calling such a big bet on the turn, I have to think what he has.
He can still have ace 10. He can still have over pairs. He's not going to be folding on the turn. I mean, as you said... And even if he has ace, king, ace in clubs, he's going to be calling once. Yeah. No matter if you bet 7 big blinds or 12 big blinds.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, your intention is to barrel it off anyway, right? So if he has a calling hand, like a flush, a set, or whatever, you're going to be losing it all by the river anyway.
Yes.
Or do you want to, or is your intention to... let's see. Oh, you check. Is your intention, let's say you don't hit the club, to just bet 20 big blinds and leave yourself something behind? Or is your intention to go all in? What's your...
My intention is when the river is blanking, I have to jam.
Yeah, then it doesn't really matter. The thing is just that, that I believe very often people would think, and this is a very natural thing to do, is why is he betting so small on the turn? Very often, you're not only going to have flushes, but you're going to have two pairs and sets. We're still playing against human beings. And I just don't see any disadvantage in betting a little bigger. But the problem is with your bluffs that you might get bluff catch a little more. And you also want to bet bigger, because if you have pocket fives or sixes, you don't want to give him such a good price with his flush draws. Or if he has pocket queens with a club, right? He has just two outs to make a better set, plus he has the additional flush draw. He can also have very weak holdings like pocket eights or pocket fours with one club that are having a lot of equity against your value hand. Now, if you bet that small, then he's not really making a mistake by calling, and he can still outdraw you with a relatively weak hand. So even if you have, let's say, an ace 10, you don't mind if he folds pocket nines, pocket eights, a weak club type of hand, because he still has so much equity.
Okay.
I mean, this is basically only a good turn if you really have a strong flush. If you have pocket fives, do we really mind to end the hand here to bet and take down the pot? Do we really want to get a call on this where you can have 9-8s and a ton of flushes? Because if we have pocket fives and let's say the river is a 3 in hearts, like... It's a bit similar as with the ace 4 hand we had earlier where you had the nut flush. It's like... Yeah, we have a strong hand, but we know we're going to be beat a lot of the times. And the pot is already getting quite big. So this is where I try to get a bigger bet in on the turn. And then probably I just end up check folding my pocket fives if he goes all in.
When you play betting bigger with like fives or 5-6 or something, when the river blank, what do you...
I usually check. I mean, we can't really play for stakes anyway anymore, right? I mean, unless he's it really depends. If I think he's going to be calling aces, kings, queens, jacks with one club full range and hero calls a 10, then I just jam. But in this stage, I doubt that. I think we value town ourselves too much. I think we're just literally getting caught by better hands very often.
Okay.
Again, it's just a small thing. Keep that in mind, because now you have 36 behind in a pot of 33. On a board where he's going to have a lot of calls. Also for your value hands, like, as I said, I think your hand as a bluffs comes a lot through your triple birds, unless he has ace five. You still get some folds on the turn. But here, if you bet, and we're gonna have more value hands than bluffs, so we first want to focus on how do we play our value hands. Here, it's so much better to bet big, and then on the river, the pot is going to be like four. Let's say you bring it to 45 big blinds and you have only 25, 28. He's going to have a harder time folding his bluff catchers, right? Because you're going to be jamming so many flushes. You're going to be jamming maybe pocket sixes, pocket tens as your weakest value hands. And then, you know, you're going to get way more lighter calls. But now with pot left, if you jam here, I don't think you can jam pocket fives anymore with an overbet all in. You know what I mean? It's just for you, it's so much easier than, okay, there's so little left, we go all in. And you also get way more calls because he's getting such a good price. If he has pocket queens with one club on, let's say, the deuce and hearts on the river, he's going to have a harder time folding it versus a 25 big blind all in a 40 big blind pot versus now you jam 36 into 33. You know what I'm saying?
Yes. Yeah. From the value perspective, I think you're right. But I don't know if I have to bluff this spot a lot of time. How many bluffs I have here, or how many
value? Well, you said it yourself. You want to triple barrel this if you hit the club, yes. Right? That I'm just recapping based on what you said, that you intend to triple barrel this. And if you have jack eight in clubs, the jack, you're probably going to have queen seven, queen eight. You have a lot that is connected around the 10 with one club, right? So I presume you're going to have a decent amount of bluffs in this spot that you're going to be triple barreling with.
Yeah, what's like hand with like 7-8? When I have 7-8, do you like to check raise 7-8 and...
Yeah, yeah.
7-4?
Yeah.
7-9?
Yeah, they're all fine.
Yes, I think I have more bluffs than value hands. Or do you?
I mean, you should be raising all of them. But if you feel like, again, if you think this is a great spot to apply pressure on, then go for it.
I think the people see betting like 100% in this
spot. Could be, yeah. As I said, also so sizing wise, it's a great spot to play it very aggressive against. Yeah.
So I thought it from the bluffing line when I'm betting the turn bigger and committing myself to the pot more, he's likely to call more. You know what I mean? So do you say when I'm betting the turn smaller, like I do, the 40%, now it's like stack to pot like the same, I have a little bit more. And when I'm jamming, he is like to fold many hands.
Of course he's folding more hands because you're also betting bigger.
But this point is it not better to have this size now? Because he's folding more?
Well, if you intend...
Because I have more bluffers?
If you intend to bluff way more, then technically, yeah. Then...
Yeah.
But you should be very, very careful. I mean, triple barrel bluffs, in general, you want to have some good cards to do it with, such as jack 8 with the jack and clubs, and also you block the 8-9. But, and this is very important, at the end of the day, I think you still have a shitload of value hands. I mean, you can raise so many flush draws, you can raise so many sets and two pairs, and this is what I would focus on. I think this is where also... Remember your EV, if you win, if you bluff on the river, you're only going to win those 33. In fact, you're only going to win net 16, right? But with your value hands, if you jam here, you're going to win way more than that. And even though you have more bluffs, you generate way more EV with your value hands. And this is what is very important to understand. Your money is not, you make a few more bucks and probably have a better win rate than a lot of the other players because you understand what's going on. But the bulk of your win rate comes through your value hands. And this is where I want to make sure that my opponent that there's a stack to pot ratio on the river where he has a harder time folding. And you will also kind of like see this in GTO, that with your value hands, you always try to choose sizings where you can play for your entire stack on the river. And if you look at these insane win rates, we did it last time, remember on your stream, if I remember correctly, we also looked in how much money we actually make with our value hands versus our bluffs, and it's insane.
Yes.
Right? So just because you have a few more bluffs, you should not change your entire strategy based on that and change the way that you apply your bet sizing. Your bet sizing should always be focused on how would I play my value hands.
Yeah.
If okay. I would always recommend choosing bluff sizings that as cheap as possible if you can still accomplish almost the same. So I would be okay if you say, I think he's going to be folding queens or jacks a decent amount of the time, so I just bet 20 big blinds. And in case you're wrong, you at least have 16 big blinds left. And you have the spin-up equity, the comeback equity.
Yeah.
But for the previous streets, because at the end of the day, you're losing the same amount of chips if he calls you, no matter what you did on the turn. But now the problem is, if he had something like pocket eights, ace king, ace and clubs, you constantly lose those 5-6 big blinds on the turn because you bet too small. If you would do that with your value hands, it's all right.
Yeah.
Right? That's totally fine. And I don't mind this line as a bluff either. We're nitpicking here.
Yeah.
It just don't think about, okay, I would be bluffing way more than I have value hands, so that's why I'm playing this strategy. If you have two different strategies, okay, I play my value hands like this, I bet big, and then I jam 2/3 pot on the river, great, perfect.
I think most of the time I have to be balanced, but maybe you can...
No, you don't need to be balanced. So. You don't need to be balanced. No, of course not. Okay. I mean, René, think about your own game. Do you really think you're balanced?
I think. I hope.
No. I think... No. No, you really don't need to be balanced. All right. I'm actually really curious to see what happens on the river here.
Yes.
Check. I mean, you'll love to see it. What did he have? It doesn't show here.
Pocket tens.
Oh. Dirty.
Yes. I don't know. Maybe it's like... it was... when I'm betting bigger the turn, I think maybe he's jamming his hand. Maybe that's maybe why I'm betting smaller. And I'm thinking about when I have the flush, I don't really want to back really big. That was so, I think that maybe that's why I'm betting smaller.
Yeah,
I think about my nut hands and maybe he's jamming.
Technically, it's the other way. I mean, the small. Just think about if you would bet one big blind. He's more inclined to raise, or
when I'm betting one big blind,
just go to the extreme.
Yes, he's raising us.
So two big blinds, three big blinds. That's where actually he's supposed to start raising more because he wants to get in money. If you bet too small,
yes.
So I think if you see, okay, this guy now he bets only seven. It's too small. This is where I also see the danger of you trying to buy a card very cheaply to hit your draw. And this is, if you bet big though, then there's a less chance of and actually I don't mind raising him because then people don't bluff raise. So it also saves us our third barrel. Very often if I'm on stream and I have the intention to triple barrel bluff and then he jams on me on the turn, I was like, all right, thank you. Because I know they never bluff these spots. And he would have gotten my entire stack if he would have not been so greedy and impatient and just jamming on me.
Yeah, and in this situation, we have the next hand. Yeah. I did it like you say it now. I was, you can go to the ace forehand.
I'm the 6-7 in spades now. Maybe let's go over this real quick. It's a four-way pot. Yes. Should be pretty much straightforward four-way. Let's see. I mean, preflop is standard. Flop is standard. Not too much to say.
Yes.
Two pair.
The turn?
Mm-hmm.
I think the turn it's... I think call is good. Jam is okay.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I see. Wait. Is he... He was the preflop raiser, right?
Yes. And this was multi-way. The sand. It was four people.
Yeah. He's
really short. And I never see him bluffing here. So yeah. When I'm raising the flop, I don't like it. Raising is a turn. Yes, you can raise, you can call. I think it's...
Yeah, turn is... Both options are fine.
Yes. Dirty, and river, dirty. I don't know if I have to... I can jam on him, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, yes. I don't hate it. I think he's going to check back ace-queen, ace-jack quite often.
Yes.
I think in these... He's literally not going to have any bluffs. I don't think this is four-way... He's gonna now triple a queen. And when the moment he never has bluffs, we can actually start shoving those.
Yes.
Yes. This looks like a big fish play, but it's, I think it's actually really good on low and mid stakes.
Yeah, I was like, in the river, it was like auto check to him. So, but
yeah,
after, I think, the reasons I calling the flop in the turn is like, he has no bluffs. So he has aces, kings, ace, king, ace, queen. And I don't think to raise in my hand. It's not a good option. Yeah. But on the river, he's checking back a lot of times his hands.
Yeah.
And anyway, if he's jamming, I calling anyway.
Yeah.
So I think it's a better play to put all the money in, and he's also calling the ace queen or ace jack.
Yeah.
And ace king, of course.
Yeah.
So maybe he's checking back ace king, maybe, when I have, when he like to check it back.
Yeah.
So, but he's never folding when I'm jamming, so I have to jam, I think.
I think jamming turn is also fine because he can still level himself into, you know, you have a draw, a combo draw. People hate folding strong ace-x hands. And on a lot of runouts, he's not going to be going on with ace-queen, ace-jack anyway. I think this is very important to... Yeah, just get the money in, either on turn or just don't jam the river. Even if... Because... Think about it like this. So let's say the river is the three in hearts. And this is very important because, again, as I just said in the previous hand, it's so important where how you play your value hands. Now, if you check, you're going to be check calling, right?
Yes.
So, but do you really think you're going to be, do you really think, let's say, the three on the river or the nine or 10, he's going to be value betting anything worth but ace king or set in this stage of the tournament? Maybe there's a chance he jams ace queen, but do you really think that's the case? So like what I'm trying to say is you basically pay him off when he has kings, sevens, aces, ace king, maybe if there's a 10, maybe if he has queen jack and spades, he hits a straight, whatever. So the problem is you pay him out and he always checks back ace queen, ace jack, ace 10. So you're going to be losing against all those hands anyway because you check call. If you jam, you also lose against these hands, but you additionally get calls from ace, queen, ace, jack, ace, 10, which are more likely because top pairs are more likely than two pairs of sets, right?
Yes.
So this is where you force him to also put in money with hands that you have beat. If you check, you never do that. Or if you never check jam the turn, or you check... I mean, on this river, it's a different story. But I mean, this is actually the only river where I think he's supposed to jam ace-queen. And he's still not doing it.
Yeah. I think when he says like ace-queen or so, he can jam the river. But...
Now people don't do that in that stage. And this is where the game changes. And all these idiot GTO warriors... Trying to, we need to balance our range. Well, but put this in a sim. Look what he's supposed to jam on the river. And you will see that a lot of these thin value jams are not happening. And you just keep losing value. You keep losing a decent part of your win rate by trying to be balanced, by trying to be, I need to protect my range here. He has no bluffs, right? As you said in that stage. So you can just, I mean, we fold our... At least I don't know how you would do it, but I would fold my ace nine on the turn if he second pairs there. After he bets into four way on the flop, then he keeps betting into our small blind calling range. Ding, 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 alarm bells. I'm not calling ace nine or ace 10 on the turn, right? So our range is pretty strong by the river anyway. Like we're going to have ace seven, we're going to have 7-6, maybe king seven suited, pocket sevens. If we didn't raise I would raise these all earlier anyway to get the money in because you... The only reason for just calling value hands is when our opponents have bluffs, that we get additional money. If that's not the case, you always want to raise it because now you miss another 18 big blinds that you could have gotten from him.
Yes, on the river, it's like I knew it. I have to jam the river. But on the flop and turn was also a thing about his value hands, and I don't want jamming the turn because I don't want a really big pot. So we can play it out, I think. I think his range is face up and my range is also really face up. We can like play it out this hand. So I
Absolutely.
like this play in this way. But on the river, I have to jam this hand. This is the thing.
Also now people might wonder, well, which bluffs do we have? Well, we don't have bluffs here.
Yes,
Because
no.
the way people think about this, or he might think about it, and a lot of the poker players are thinking about is, oh my God, what can he have? Like maybe 8-9 in spades, 4-5
Nothing.
in spades, 10-8 in spades, 10-9 in spades, right? Like, okay, I'm gonna call ace queen and hearts.
Yeah.
But we would never do that, right? So
Yeah. But this was like the river.
yeah.
But this was like the six is coming. I never thinking about the six on the river. I was like thinking, okay, I have to have two pairs. I call him down, and the
Yeah.
flush is coming. I think I have to. I don't know. I don't know if the flush is coming and what I have to do.
I would also bet small.
Yeah, okay.
He's queen. Yeah, I don't hate the call taking the lower variance line. It's fine.
Yes. Yes, the ace queen. I'm calling the small blind. For my player, he was the tightest player in the tournament.
Okay.
He's doing nothing. No three bettings, no stealing, nothing. He was the tightest player ever in this tournament, and so I don't really want to raise ace queen here against
No,
him.
that makes a lot of sense, yeah. I mean, flop and turn are also pretty standard. Maybe let's talk about the river.
Yes. The river, I don't see here any bluffs in his range.
Yeah.
He's betting like three barrels on this board against me.
Yeah, but he bets the turn very small, so it's like a mix between checking and betting, right? It's not really a big bet, so
Yeah.
I have to take it with a little bit of grain of salt.
Yeah. And in this situation when he's betting so big the river, maybe I beating like ace jack or
Yeah.
kings, maybe, but he's don't play this. I don't think he playing kings like this. And
Yeah.
for me, it's really important that I don't have the queen and hearts in my hand. It's really for me, because I don't blocking like king queen, queen
Okay,
jack of hearts.
Rini, I have to stop you here.
Yeah,
I
okay.
really like the way that you approach it, that you say, okay, he has been the tightest player. I don't want a 3-bet ace queen. Now you go again into blockers, and I was like, how do you think he's gonna play his king queen, queen jack with one heart on flop or turn? Do you really think he barrels it? Or if you say, again, I'm just holding you accountable to your own thoughts. Because the way you're describing him, I would actually assume he's checking those anyway at some point. He's not this type of guy, I'm gonna barrel everything every time I have a draw. Right? Isn't it then a little more likely that he's probably checking king, queen, queen, jack with one heart? If he's that tight, if
Yes,
you think he has the
I
tightest player on the table, because
yes,
you're making
yes.
these extreme assumptions, but then when it comes to making adjustments, you then treat him like a normal player. And this is not coherent. It doesn't match with what you were saying. This is where I just want to challenge you to, okay, maybe I'm still thinking a little bit too much about balancing and shit in those spots.
Yes, I was only thinking about my how many value hands he had. And when I had a hand that it's more unlikely that he has beat me,
Yeah.
so maybe I have to call this hand because I have to think about my weakest range.
Yeah. Don't think
For
about your
me,
weakest range. Just think
yes.
about your hand. Does he value bet weaker hands?
Maybe ace jack, maybe.
Okay.
But
Is it
yes.
also likely that he bets a flush that small on the turn?
Maybe yes.
Really? He
I
bets
think
three
yes.
big blinds into a pot of 10 big blinds with a flush?
Yes.
How likely do you think this is?
I think it's likely in his in how he's playing, I think it's
Okay.
really likely.
Okay. I mean, I don't hate the fold. I just think it's very unlikely that people, even tight players, I mean, that's why they're tight players. They wait for good hands and usually they then, you know, put in some money into the pot. I don't hate the fold. I think 10 big blinds for me is the limit. Up to 10 big blinds, I would still call. Because for me, the more obvious line is that he has an ace nine, ace jack type of hand. Also two pair, usually ace 10. If we go to the flop, he would very often bet ace 10 bigger. He would very often bet pocket fours bigger. It's a very coordinated board, connects very well with our small blind. This is, again, not rocket science. This is just, oh, he has a good hand, dangerous board, let's put a little bit more money into the pot. This is how a lot of poker players think. And I'm just trying to work in with what is likely and what is not so likely. So I think it's quite likely that actually ace 10, ace 4 might be betting bigger on the flop already. So now, but he has ace jack, maybe he has ace 9. He doesn't want to build such a big pot. Now the flush comes in. He wants to protect his hand. He doesn't want to give a free card. Check it back, then face a big river bet. So that's why he wants to keep the initiative. That's why he bets only 3 big blinds. We call. Now he makes trips. He's like, yeah, wow, I got trips now. I probably have to bet again. Now he bets his ace jack. He bets his. Of course, he can do that. The same with ace king. Don't get me wrong.
Yes.
Right? So this is where I just think there's a good chance that he still has ace jack, ace nine, or maybe ace eight even, or ace king. Right? And it's just the way the hand has played out, his bet sizings. I mean, you know from low stakes, mid stakes, that very often big bets on turn or flop are already an indicator for some better hands. So this is where how I would approach that. Not saying it might be absolutely right. I might have flaws here, or this is just based on my experience. That I just want you to just think about it, if there is some truth in it.
Yeah, when I think about when he has like one heart in his hand, I think he's checking the turn every time.
Yeah, yeah.
In this case, I play along with him.
Yeah.
When he's betting flop and turn, and I'm calling two times here in this situation, he know I have a strong hand.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't see bluffs in his
I agree on that, yeah.
line. I have to think how many ace X I beating here.
But and you can against the small, you can have ace 2 suited, ace 5 suited, ace 6, ace 7, right? So he could easily value bet ace jack against you.
Yeah, this is the only hand I think I can beat ace jack. But mm-hmm. I don't think ace 9, ace 8 is he's playing like this.
Okay.
So I decide to fold. But I was thinking about when I have the queen of hearts in my hand, but you say it's no matter or...
Yeah, I don't think it really matters. Yeah.
Okay.
Because I just think that he's not going to be bluffing with queen, jack, queen and hearts if there's like usually people give it up on the river. Especially when you have the read that he has been the tightest and least active player on the table.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. All right. I decide in this moment to fold and I think it's okay, but I mark this hand and I have to think about what I want to call here in this situation. Like, what do I'm with ace jack maybe? Ace jack fold?
Yeah. I would call ace queen, probably fold ace jack, and this is how I would.
Yeah.
And there's a good chance you split as well. You can have still ace queen,
also,
right?
Yes.
I actually really lean towards calling. But it's close. I don't hate it. I think it's just slightly better to call this spot.
Yeah.
Yeah. But much respect for finding the fold there. I don't think a lot of players would be capable of doing that.
Yeah. I think it's really close. So it's like the ace jack, ace queen. The next hand we have.
Yeah, ace four. I'm already on the flop. I mean,
yes, ace
pretty
four,
standard.
You
raise the flop.
Here also information for this opponent. He was like, was an aggressive, never folding player. Never. He's like, I know when I'm raising here, I trigger him.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe I calling my two pairs.
Yeah.
But
no, I think I like your raise. I mean,
Yeah, but when I have here someone who likes to bluff and finds a fold, so I really like to call here to let him bluff. But he was like a guy, when I'm raising, he's like, I'm not folding. What do you want? You don't raise preflop. So I put pressure on you.
Yeah.
So, and that is the case I want to raise here.
Yeah.
But, he click it back.
Okay, this guy. Yeah, there's a good adjustment. I also like now the fact that you jam on the turn. Because again, yeah, he's an aggressive opponent. But now if he has ace king, if he has 4-5, there's going to be a bunch of action killers on the river where it goes check, check. So
yeah, and yes, and why this was like you say 10 minutes ago, when you try to bluff and someone is jamming his hand, you say he can get more ships from me.
Yeah.
But in this case, I think the ships, it was like the last three tables, two tables or something like this. I think when he has like queen deuce, I don't want that he has the chance to suck me out in this pot. The pot was so big and had so much value in this case.
Yeah.
I want to protect my hand against a three outer. I don't want really that the river is like coming maybe a 7 of clubs or a deuce and in hits like his 5 or 10%.
Mm-hmm.
I think the ships had a lot of more value in this case, in this stage.
Yeah, I mean,
it's like a 90 big blind spot and I don't really want, on the turn I was jamming and saying in the streams, so if he's calling, okay, when he's falling, it's also fine. It's a really big pot and it's had a lot of value, this hand. Maybe he's bluffing with king 6 or 10 6 and I don't want a, like he's
yeah, but you could on the other hand win another 4 million if he just jams the 10 6 into you, which I doubt is going to happen. That's why I'm fine with your jam, but if I play against certain players, calling is definitely better.
Yes.
Because yeah, you sacrifice him to potentially hit one of his four outs, but you just get so much more out of him by bluffing another 4 main ships, another 17 big blinds. It's just not happening enough. So, but I see your point and it makes sense. You're right. But also only under the assumption that he, has, as you said, maybe something like 10-6 here, right? That he clicks it back or king 7 or king 6, whatever. I mean, what he's goofing around with. So
7-3 or 7-2, I don't know.
Yeah, we don't know.
Maybe 7-2.
Yeah.
So,
but of course, it's totally fine. I mean, big pot here. Yeah.
Yes, and he's falling on the turn, and I like. Also, I really, for my feelings, I like that he gives. He's falling, and it's like 90 big blinds, and I can do a lot of more. I don't want to risk like if I have 90 big blinds or 106. It's for me no difference. It's a big stack in this point.
Yeah.
And that's why I want to end this hand here on the turn.
Okay, fair enough.
So, yes.
Great. I mean, we got in a lot of hands. Thank you so much for taking the time. Do you have any other questions? I mean, we're here to learn from those hands.
Yeah, this was all the hands before the final table.
Mm-hmm.
In the final table, we have a lot of ICM pressure then.
Yeah.
It's like from 5k to 60k pay jumps.
Yeah.
It's like in the $22 tournament. There was a lot of ICM special hands.
All right. René, then thank you so much for taking your time, joining here, sharing those hands with me. I hope you guys find some value in it. I think it's very important to always think about what you want to accomplish with your hands. Don't try to think so much what you want to accomplish with your range. Try to play your hand good. And as we've seen here and there, René could have extracted a bit more value, but overall played it very solid, took some aggressive lines, which I think it's a good mix. And I think you're also the type of player that shows this kind of ability. And it's sometimes we will fail, everyone does, but finding a good mix between being aggressive, but also making good laydowns and being very mindful about your stack and where you want to invest it. Because especially in those deep runs, the game changes entirely. People bluff less. Some players get overly aggressive, like on our Steenbeck friend here. And you really want to adjust your game based on these. And maybe find alternative lines. But never, never neglect the way you want to play your value hands, because this is where most of your win rate comes from. All right.
Yes.
René.
Thank you.
Again, congrats on this huge score and hope you guys enjoyed it. And yeah, good luck at the tables. See you guys.
Thank you.
And if you've got any questions about these hands, then feel free to drop a comment. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Thank you guys and see you next time.